Well, it's Friday, and I hope it's been a good week for you. I hope that you've benefited from these devotionals. I know many of you are pretty faithful and committed to listening to these every day, and I thank you for allowing me to do that and trusting me with that responsibility. I just want you to know this is something I take really seriously and I pray about, and my hope and my desire is that you will grow strong in the faith and become a real asset to the kingdom of God and a blessing to those whom you have in your life. But we come now to an issue that has always been really a painful one for me. And it's basically, he says that somebody who is in a position of leadership should not pursue dishonest gain. And there's a lot of confusion in the church because sometimes we think that if people are financially successful or if they have a high income or a lot of money and things like that, that the only way they can get that is by being dishonest. And that's simply not true, I would like to say. I mean, I think that many in the younger generation, especially what they call the Generation Z and maybe many millennials, have been kind of reared in that kind of socialist mindset that if somebody has more than you have, they had to get it dishonestly. The truth of the matter is that Proverbs is very clear that if you work hard and you're honest and you're diligent, that you will prosper. And it makes perfect sense. I mean, it's part of the laws of the universe. I mean, if you're going to grow a garden and you put the seed in the ground and then you walk away and you just hope that it produces a bountiful harvest, you're going to be disappointed because the weeds are going to encroach and steal nutrients from the plants so that they aren't able to produce effectively. If you plant them too closely and you don't prune them out or thin them out, they won't be able to grow as much as you would like them to. There's a whole lot of things you have to do that really translates into hard work. In fact, I'll be honest, when I was a kid, when I wanted money, my parents told me that I had to go out and get a job. So starting at about the age of 12, I used to go out to the farms with my brother. Parents would take us out there and we'd pick tomatoes, we'd pick peaches, we'd pick whatever they would let us pick to make some money. And oftentimes it was piecework. You know, you fill up a lug, a crate, a wooden box, and then they would, you know, pay you accordingly. And that was really, really hard work. And I did that all the way through my high school years. And one thing that became very clear in my mind was I did not want to be a farmer. Because quite honestly, it is really hard work. And I say it, especially I have such respect for those of you who are farmers and who enable us to have food on our table. That's something that many people don't even realize. They think that the food just magically appears in the grocery store. But these are people who work really hard. They work really long hours, and they take tremendous risks. And so even though it may not make me happy if the price of a product goes up because of a scarcity or a bad season or whatever the dynamic is, my hope is always that the farmer's going to make an extra profit because they have many years where they don't make any profit at all. And so, again, I think there's a real illusion that we have in our culture. I would say, on the other hand, we have a dynamic in our society where the whole reason people go into certain enterprises is to make money. In fact, when my oldest son was studying pre-med, when he first went to college, he decided later to go into the ministry, but he was studying pre-med, and he told me that most of the students that were in the pre-med program were motivated by having a high-paying job. And I was kind of saddened and disappointed by that because I think about, do I want to be treated by a doctor who simply is doing what he does to generate as much money as he possibly can? In fact, I remember I had one surgery that I needed to have, and I went to a local physician, and he basically wanted to get me in surgery right away and gut me like a fish. I decided to go to a hospital on the west side in the University of Washington, where they were really one of the research hospitals, one of the three top research hospitals for my particular problem. And I got talking to the guy, I got an appointment with the guy who was the head of the entire program, and which people told me you couldn't do. I just asked for it and they gave it to me. I had to wait 2 months. But as we sat down talking about my case and he was looking at all the details, he said, really, we can just wait. We don't have to rush into this. We can wait and see how things develop. But as I was talking with him, telling him what the other doctor wanted to do, he said to me, well, the problem with this kind of surgery is there's a lot of money in it. And he said, being a research hospital, you know, these guys weren't doing it for the money. They were doing it for the research, and they were already well compensated. He was very successful and known internationally for his work and published as a result. But the whole point was that the doctor that I had gone to really was driven by a desire to do as many surgeries in as quick a time to generate as much money as he possibly could. And I don't believe that's true of all doctors or surgeons, but I just know in the case with this individual, I'm pretty sure that that was his motivation. Well, again, that's dishonest gain. In other words, dishonest gain isn't just stealing money from people, which is certainly dishonest, but it's doing stuff that generates a profit for you at the expense of other people that's unnecessary. And so if you have a doctor who's treating you unnecessarily for things because it just generates more income for his practice, or if you have a dentist, as I had a friend of mine who had a dentist who was giving him fillings when he didn't need them just because he was trying to generate more money. It's a guy who tries to sell you a car that you know isn't right for you or you can't afford, and he's just doing it simply because he wants to make more money. Those are all kind of things that show a lack of honesty and integrity. I just remember when my dad was trying to buy me a car to drive back up to Oregon. I was down in California, and he took me to, we were looking up for cars. He saw one that was inexpensive and looked like a good deal. So we went out to this gentleman's farm where he had this car, and he was showing it to us and telling us, you know, it was a good, reliable vehicle. And he said, well, what do you want to do with it? And I said, well, I'm planning on driving up to Oregon. And immediately he looked at me and said, then you can't have this car. I said, why? He says, because I can't guarantee that it will support you on that long of a journey. He said, this is not the car for you. And I was struck by that honesty. Here was a man who didn't want to sell a car and get it off his back because he was afraid that it wouldn't be a good consequence for me. And that's kind of the attitude I think that many of us need to have. I mean, for all I know, the man was a Christian because he had that kind of integrity, although I knew a lot of those farmers where I grew up were just like that. They were people who were mindful of the effects of their actions upon other people. But saying all of that, it's the idea of being greedy for money is really reprehensible, especially when it comes into the ministry. And, you know, in our church, we have made it a practice. We just don't talk about money. And I mean, I'll teach what the Bible says when I come to it in a particular passage, but we don't go around trying to get money out of people. You know, I've been at churches where they pass the plate and they look at it and say it's not enough, and they pass it again, and they keep on passing it until the pastor decides he's got enough money in the plate. The one that used to drive me crazy was the Christian television, where you'd have these guys who are basically telling you, you know, give to the ministry because this is a year of the 1,000% blessing. I remember that line, the 1,000% blessing. If you give a dollar, God will give you $1,000 back. And so you need to send in $100 right now and get that 1,000% blessing. And I thought to myself, if he really believes that, he'd be sending me $1,000 so that he could make $100,000. I mean, the whole idea was ridiculous because it was all about inducing people who are gullible, I'm afraid, simple in their faith, if you will, who trusted these guys, to be able to manipulate those people in order to get money out of them. And, you know, many of those ministries have become big and successful and have huge facilities and so forth. I remember, you know, one particular ministry in had a big write-up in the LA Times that the guy and his wife who were running this thing had 8 different homes, luxury homes, in places like Las Vegas and Palm Springs and Florida and Hawaii and all over the place. And they drove in these great cars and they lived this expensive lifestyle. But they were always constantly pressing people to give their money. Here's my advice. Before you ever give money to any ministry, or before you invest money in anything, you know, like the advertisements for gold and silver and different things like that or whatever, before you ever purchase something, you should always pray, God, is this what you want me to do? Now, I don't mean about basic necessities, but I mean, you know, I ask the Lord all the time. Sometimes I want to buy a power tool and I just look at it because I can want to buy a power tool just to have the power tool, even if I don't use it. And I have to step back and go, God, is this really the best choice for me? Is this what I'm supposed to do? And I think that especially when you have people who are asking you to give money to the ministry, pray about those ministries that you invest in. That my wife and I are very careful and fastidious about different ministries, because we certainly support our own church that we're supported by, but we also are invested in other ministries, mission works and different things that we believe in. And it's really important to us that we prayed about it and we feel very clear in our heart that we are investing in the kingdom of God and not just giving it to some organization. I mean, there's secular organizations that I invest into, things that like, I mean, St. Jude's Hospital or things like Tunnel to Towers. You know, we used to be really excited about Wounded Warrior Project, and I'm sure they're good now, but it came out a while later that the guy who was running it was really keeping a lot of the funds for himself. And so, you know, we got discouraged. We found another organization doing similar things, and we've been investing in them because, you know, the majority of their money, 93% of their money, goes directly to the recipients of the aid. And I believe that with mission organizations as well, that we really try to make sure that these are things that are going to really go directly to the people. And fortunately, in some cases, I know the people who are running the organization, so I know how much integrity they have. But these are just important questions. And that's why even our church, we do every month a different reach initiative where we focus on another ministry and encourage our people to support that ministry. But these are things that we've done our due diligence to find out, are they solid ministries? Are they really doing the work that they're saying they're doing? Are they using the monies carefully and faithfully? And I just think that that's an important thing for us, that we use our resources, we spend them well. God entrusts monies to you and me so that we will be faithful with those monies. And we can't be perfect, obviously, but we really do our due diligence to make sure that those things are used in a way that honors the Lord. Well, enough for that. God bless you. I pray that you have a great weekend. Pray you have a great Sunday morning, worshiping wherever that may be. Blessings.